Hey guys, in this video I wanted to talk about self-avoiding walks, which are a special case of random walks. And I basically just wanted to introduce them as a mathematical concept and maybe go over a little bit of the basics of what they are and how they work. So let's go ahead and get started with that. So a random walk is a kind of like concept or branch of mathematics. It's called lattice theory usually, and it basically works as follows. So let's use the simple case of we're just in two dimensions, although you can expand this to also three dimensions. And suppose you have a lattice or a grid. Then basically a random walk is how can you move and take steps from an initial point, let's say A, how do you move in this lattice space? So a random walk is basically just programmed to randomly move in 2D space. So in 2D space, you have four options. You can move up, right, down, or left at each step. And each step basically is an edge from, if you think of this as a node, then each step is just an edge that takes you from one step to the next, or from one location to the next. And so this is an idea in mathematics called a random walk. Self-avoiding random walks or self-avoiding walks are random walks that have the additional property, which is that they do not cross. So at each step, when we're moving, a regular random cross can go back to where it started from, and it can pass and basically create crosses like this. But a self-avoiding walk cannot do that. So for a self-avoiding walk, you are not allowed to move back to a place where you already were, and so you cannot create crosses. So let's say this is the first step I take. So I'm starting from here and I go step one. So this is one step, this is step two, this is step three. At step three, I can't go to the left anymore because that would be going back to a point that I already visited. And I can't go down anymore either because I already visited this point as well. So at step three, for a self-avoiding walk, I only have two possibilities. I can go up or I can go to the right. And so this creates random walks that look a little bit different from regular random walks because you basically cannot cross them. When we are creating random walks, we usually refer to d as the distance or the size of the random walk. So if I want d equal to 15, that basically means I want a random walk or a self-avoiding walk that takes 15 steps. And so if you're programming something like that in computer science, if you want a self-avoiding walk at step 15 that takes 15 steps, you're going to run into some problems where your self-avoiding walk has to terminate early because it gets stuck. So let me do an example. Let's say we start here at A. I'm going to go to the left one, go down two, go to the right two, and then go up and left. At this point B, this self-avoiding walk has to terminate because I'm left with no other options of where to go. So let's say I've just randomly moved left, down, down, right, up, left. At this point, the self-avoiding walk has to terminate because I have no options of where to go. I can't go down because I already visited this point here. I can't go right, I can't go up, and I can't go left. So this self-avoiding walk has D or length 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this has to have a size 7, and you can't keep going. So this could have been randomly generated in a computer program that creates self-avoiding walks, and it would not count as a self-avoiding walk that has 15 steps. So basically, you have to kind of iterate through a couple tries of making random self-avoiding walks until you get one that actually reaches the desired length. This is basically like a problem that you sometimes have to solve. So one way that you can avoid getting into this position where you're stuck and you have to terminate early is by doing an algorithm called the n-step look-ahead algorithm. With an n-step look-ahead algorithm, let's say we do a one-step look-ahead algorithm. That says that at each point before we move, we're going to look and see, or you have a computer program, look and see what does the future look like. So you look one step ahead. So let's say I move up. It makes sure basically that where you randomly move is available at that nth step. So if you have a one-step look-ahead algorithm, at each point you look one step ahead to see where you can move before you actually make that random move. If you do a two-step look-ahead, you make sure to move only where you are sure you have two possible steps that you can take in the future before you actually make a move. So you can increase the end. You can look 3 steps ahead, 4 steps ahead. You can increase the end, but basically it becomes more computationally difficult for large end to keep looking ahead before you have the random walk move. And then jumping to another topic, I also wanted to mention that it's very easy to calculate the probability of getting a certain self-avoiding walk. So this is actually how I learned about self-avoiding walks, because you can create them basically using like Monte Carlo methods, and it's also very easy to calculate their probabilities. So basically at each step, you would just update the probability using basic counting rules. So this was a self-avoiding walk that was created using a one-step look-ahead algorithm. And it's a size 9, meaning it took 9 steps. So if I wanted to calculate the probability of getting this exact self-avoiding walk, this 9-step self-avoiding walk, you do that very easily as follows. At each node, you calculate the probability of being able to move to the next spot, and then you just multiply each event, because it's basically each step is independent of the previous one, because you're just making a random step each time. And so you just calculate the probability at each step. So for 9 steps, you have 9 independent probabilities. You multiply them, and then that would be the overall probability of getting this self-avoiding walk. So for example, for this graph, we're starting here at the first point. When we look ahead, we have 1 out of 4 probabilities of moving anywhere, because we can move up, down, right, or left. So the first step, we have 1 out of 4 probability of moving to the left. Here we moved to the left, and now we can no longer go back to the right because we already visited this node. So at the second node, we have a 1 out of 3 probability of moving somewhere. So we can move up, left, or down. So the second event was 1/3. When we go to the third node, we can no longer go up, but we can go to the left, down, or right. So that's going to be 1/3 probability. Here, the node is going to have a 1/2 probability. We can no longer go up because that was our first node that we visited, and we cannot go to the left. So we have 2 possibilities. For this node, we have 3 again. So that's going to be 1/3 probability of moving anywhere. For here, we can go 1/3 places again. At this node, we cannot go left or down. So we have 1 out of 2 possibilities of going somewhere. At this node, we have 1 out of 3. And finally, at this node, we have 1 out of 3 again. So that would get us from point A to point B, and this would be the probability of having this self-avoiding walk. When we do this multiplication, getting this self-avoiding walk of size 9 using the one step ahead algorithm would be a probability of 1 over 11664. And that's it for this video.